بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers, sisters, teachers, teaching this, we're looking at Unit 2, Islamic Beliefs, and page 30 of the book, Qadr, the story of Musa and Khidr, alayhim as-salam. Now, we're looking at this story and we're also looking at fate and how it sort of, you know, combines together. Now, how to teach this? One thing, we want to come into the lesson and we want to, you know, tell the story without actually having to refer to the book itself, without having to read every single line of the story. You know, we want to really just focus on just the children, their eyes, and just tell them the story. Now, once you've said the story, and if you look actually on our online teacher training that we've got, it's got a section there of storytelling. You know, you can dramatize it and so on, and put certain voices or certain tones, whatever, inside to actually make it feel like a narrative that is really exciting. So anyway, that's something you will do. And then when you've come to this part, you know, these single parts need all to be explained. Now, what you could do is, if you can take your class out and you can actually take them by a nearby tree, okay, you give them a little thing to do. The tree most likely has leaves on it, and you give them a project to do. You give them different branches of the tree, different people of the class, or okay, different students. You give them different branches of a tree and you say, okay, I want you to count how many leaves on this particular branch. Give them that task. Now, they might sort of, you know, find it really difficult. Most likely they're going to find it really difficult to count those leaves. The idea is for them to actually find it difficult to do that task. And even if they were to count all the leaves of one branch, then you've given them an idea that to count now all the leaves of the entire branches of the entire tree is going to be almost mission impossible. And then you want to prove to them that that's just one tree. What about the next tree and the next tree? And they'll think, oh my God, don't you dare, you know, tell us to try and look at another tree and try and figure out how many leaves it's got. Well, then the point is that Allah Azza wa Jal knows, as what we've demonstrated here, Allah Azza wa Jal knows every single, you know, part of every leaf, of not even just how many leaves. He knows the shape of the leaf. He knows the weight of the leaf. He knows the weight today. He knows the weight tomorrow. He knows how much sun is going to shine on the tree. He knows what raindrops are going to fall on the leaf or the tree. He knows when that leaf is going to fall down, and he knows every single minute detail of it. Now, you want to do this perhaps by actually having the leaf in your hand and explaining all of this, because that's what they're going to remember from the lesson, to understand the broad, you know, the wide sort of, you know, ihata, the greatness of how Allah Azza wa Jalla has his knowledge surrounding matters. Now, if you can't go outside of the class and if you can't go to a tree, then perhaps you could bring a branch in with leaves on it, or if that's difficult for you, you can bring something else in. Okay, something else in. Perhaps you bring in you could bring in a container of toothpicks, okay? Toothpicks, and you could open it. You know, if it says it was 100 in the box, you could take a few out, and you know, they don't know what the number is, and get them straight away to count the toothpicks by just dropping it in front of them. You know, maybe you get two or three bunches and you get groups there, and you just drop it right in front of them and get them to quickly count it. Now, by the time they've counted it, you then need to say, okay, gather it together, put it back into the box, but they should know that Allah Azza wa Jal knew how many toothpicks they were before it even was dropped out. You know, in the container, he knew it. He knew how many. He even knows every single toothpick, whether it's going to be used or not, who's going to use it, where they're going to use it, which tooth they're going to use it for, whether that teeth place, whatever they use it, is going to bleed or not, whether, you know, whatever meat that was in there or some other, you know, item of food was in there, what that item of food is, you know, how long it's been there, where it came from, where it's going to go, you know, all of those things. So the point is not to just keep it to the toothpicks or whatever you bring. The point is to say the entire, you know, show them the broad vastness of Allah's knowledge, okay? Now, that's one aspect of showing them the broadness of his knowledge. Another thing you could do is, you want to you want to then have a discussion. Okay, this is part of the lesson. You want to try and have a discussion of some of these students that are studying this and ask them about a small incident or something that happened in their life where they thought it was something, but then they were happy later on that it actually happened. Okay, or they couldn't understand something at one point and then they understood later on. Now, don't forget, certain students, they might not have, they've only just had about 11 years of life, 12 years of life, whatnot. So they might not be able to tell you any incident like that. So you might have to relate one from yourself. Okay. Now, as a teacher, if I wanted to relate one, I could relate one of once my father, he came home, and this was in Bangladesh, and he complained that a certain bus he was going to get onto, you know, it was really jam-packed. Those countries, their buses are sardine cans. So he was waiting there and he had the right to get onto the bus. But unfortunately, the driver, the conductor said, no, you can't get on, and he let other passengers on. Now, my dad was fuming. Why has he been standing at the front? It was his right to get on, but they never allowed him. And he couldn't understand this, so he waited. He waited till the second bus came, and he got onto the second bus, but he was still, angry with what happened with the first bus. He should have got home 20 minutes earlier. But then as the second bus was going, he looked at all the passengers, la ilaha illallah, they were stunned, because the first bus had an accident and the whole bus had turned over with the people inside it, la ilaha illallah. People inside it, sardine canned, and you can imagine how many people are now coming out of this, whether people survive or not survive, whether people go to hospital or not go to hospital. And he came back home telling us this story, and we thought, la ilaha illallah, look at the qadr of Allah, look at how Allah saved my father from this incident, because he could have been gone from this world if he had been on that bus. And look at how he's getting frustrated, but at the same time Allah Azza wa Jalla teaches him that, look, I saved you. Now, these things happen sometimes we'll be able to see the thing, all right? Now, if you've got a story yourself as a teacher, if you know any other stories, then do relate those stories and have a discussion. Now, try not to have students get into things that will make them really sad and worried. Like, for example, if one of them has lost a baby brother or lost a baby sister or something, it's not a good idea to open those kind of discussions, because it's going to cause grief and you might not know how to even deal with it. The person might be in tears. So try, it could be a parent that they've lost or something else has happened, some accident. Try not to make it too tragic or too much of a discussion that go into things that are, the things that are real tragic in people's lives, or things that are major events. Try to avoid them. Try and look at some minor event or something that was a good case scenario, like the one I just related to you. It actually shows you, Allah did this for a reason, to save one person. Not getting onto that. Okay. Now, for whatever reason it happened that those people went through that, Allah has the details of that. Okay. Now, it'll be good for you to have some background knowledge of certain things to explain to them that, look, everything comes out to be, everything will be judged in the right direction by the end. So, for example, in a hadith, we've got about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talking about a group of people. This is a hadith in Bukhari, where a group of people, or a hadith in Muslim, they will head for the Kaaba to try and destroy the Kaaba. But they'll come to a place called Bayda, which is near Medina, and the whole earth will suck them inside. Now, Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked, she said, Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, Messenger of Allah, yukhsafu awwaluhum wa akhiruhum, the first and the last will all be sucked in. What about the salihun? What about the good people that were amongst them? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, all of them will be swallowed in, but Allah will raise them up on the day of judgment according to their intention. If the intention was bad, then Allah will judge them according to that. If the intention was good, Allah will let them off, basically. So this hadith again shows us that, yes, someone like, some people could be in a bus crash, whatever, and they could all be gone. But Allah Azza wa Jal will, resurrect them, and He will judge them according to whatever status they were in. And everyone gets a separate judgment, and everyone has a separate, whole thing of, what happened to them in their life beforehand, why Allah did that. They will all be compensated, or for some of them, it could have been a punishment. and therefore they deserve that punishment. But that punishment itself could be a very light thing, where compared to the punishment of the Akhirah, Allah Azza wa Jalla let them off again, because He gave them a very light punishment on the earth by having an accident compared to hellfire that is there in the next world. Now again, everything, you know, is out there for explanation. We don't know, but our idea is to open the minds of the students to, you know, so many possibilities, and to know that Allah will do their best in the end. Okay, so one thing is to get their class together and to get certain incidents being reported or said and a discussion to happen. Another thing you could do, and this is a good way of getting the students to be to actually, you know, have a bit of a kind of a game. Okay, so what you do is you get groups of children. Let's just say, for example, you've got four in a group or five in a group. What happens is you set up a scenario, okay? So the scenario that you set is, okay, I'm going to, you know, I'm going for a fun day, you know, weekend day, whatever it was, Saturday or something, and I'm going to go to town. So that's the scenario that you've set. Now, what the other four have to do, now what happens is one of those five, they get this scenario. So they say, okay, you know, they say it loudly. So you've got a piece of paper where you put, set the scenario. I'm going to town center and I'm going to have fun with my friends, okay? So they've got this in front of them. That's the scenario. It's supposed to be a lovely day. I want to go and have fun with my friends, and then I'm going to come back home. Okay. Now the other four people, they have got pieces of paper in their hands. It could be three people. Okay. So there's two people that are there, and one person has a scenario. It could be four people that are here, and one person has a scenario. It depends how you want to do this. Now, what happens is, if there's two people, they both have to write something that happens to me, okay? And I've got to then deal with the problem there and then. So it could be, all right, let's just say, for example, both what they're going to write is a choice that I've got, okay? So the teacher has set the scenario, I'm going to have fun day. But the teacher will then give, you know, if you take that paper and you look at the second paper the teacher's given, it says, you know, it's probably raining very heavily, so we can't enjoy ourselves in the park where we're going to go, okay? Now, that's the scenario that's set. I was supposed to go to town. In the first part was, it's going to look lovely. So that's the first thing Khadr, I'm looking at. The second piece of paper, when I turn it over and I look at the other side, it says, you know, or the second piece of paper says to me that it's really heavy, you know, raining heavily. So now these two people that are sitting there, they're going to write my choices. One choice, okay, one of them could probably write is that, you know, we go somewhere else. Now, where's that place we go to? So he could write any place he wants. The second person could say, okay, we go into the mall. Okay, we go into the mall, right? So the scenario is sort of set. We go to the mall. Now, I've got a choice. Do I stay outdoors or do I go to the mall? Now, if there was a third person here, he could say, well, I head back home, all right? So I can see three choices there that are happening. Now, I have to take one of them. So I decide, okay, I'm sitting here. I'm the person who started off with the scenario. I say, okay, I'm going to go into the mall. I'll take that choice. Okay, so me and my friends are going to go into the mall. Now, as soon as I've taken that, what these three people have to do again is they have to give me three other choices, right? Now, it could be from bad to good. It could be anything, right? So one of them could say, for example, you know, my phone is stolen, right? So he gives that. So one of them has to say, okay, now we're going to say that your phone is stolen. Now we're going to then give you a choice. What do you do? Is it that you, you know, straight away start just searching for the phone where you've tracked back? Do you sort of go and call the police, or do you go and borrow a friend's phone and then call, you know, your parents and say, my phone has been stolen? What do you do there and then? Okay. Now, let one of these other people set you another thing, right? And if these students are not able to do all of that, what you could do is you could beforehand pack in five different, you know, parts in an envelope. So you have an envelope. You have number one, it says, I'm going to town to have a good time. But then what happens is that's the first thing. But then straight away he says, with that is that it's raining heavily, what do I do? Do I go here, there, and so on? So that's a choice that they have to make. But then the second one, all right, the second paper inside the envelope says, your phone has been stolen. And let these people give the scenario of what the choices are and what I do. But then the third one could say, okay, now, okay, you chose, you know, this could be the teacher setting all this himself or herself. You chose to actually, you know, go and ask, and you found one of the shopkeepers said, oh, I saw somebody running away from you, and it looked like he carried a phone in his hand. What do? Do you chase the person? Now, you could set the scenario, and then later on you could say, well, you then come to a choice where you meet that person, you see him, you know who he is, you find him, and do you now confront him to give you a phone because he's got other friends with him, or do you still call the police, right? Now, again, the choices are there, but let the people start to judge, the groups of students start to judge what might not happen in each of these cases, okay? Let them judge what might happen. But what this shows is, this shows that this person here, myself, who's given this envelope, I've got a choice in every one of these things, and I'm making the choice as I'm going along. Now, Allah's knowledge, what we want to have a discussion of in the end is, whatever scenario you said, I just gave you a random scenario, okay? You can choose any other scenario you want. You can even have four different scenarios, okay, of what they sort of have as a choice to what to do. And this can be, you know, played along with them. But what you want to do is, you want to gather the groups together, and then you want to have a sort of, you know, awareness of what was it that the person made a choice, and why did they make that choice? Okay, did anyone force them to make that choice? Do they think that Allah has written that they must do this, must do that, must do, or were they actually making the choice? But at the same time, we realize that certain events have happened, like the phone was stolen. It's not in our hands, it just happened. And then the choices that we make, we fall into other choices, okay, that we can make. And so there's certain things that Allah's restricting us to. Like, for example, I went out to have a nice time, but then the rain came down. Now that's Qadr Allah. That makes me have a choice. Do I want to stay out in the rain? Do I want to go back home? Do I want to go in the mall? Now, again, that is a choice which I make, but Allah Azza wa Jal, He brought down the rain, so that's a qadr that shifts me to make a different choice. The phone is stolen, it shifts me to make a certain thing, or maybe, it could, you know, because with this phone, you could argue that it's somebody that did that, but again, did Allah make that person do that for some reason? What happened there? Or did Allah allow it to happen? Okay, fine. The person who actually stole the phone, he had a free will of his own. Now, we don't know, you know, again, what the extent of that will be in the afterlife, why they stole it, all that. That's all in Allah's knowledge. So we're not here to discuss that. But it could have been something else. It could have been, I had an accident. Okay, it could have been, I was on the escalators and I was coming down, and suddenly, you know, someone came push me from behind and I had an accident, I fell down. Okay, or it could have been a natural accident where I slipped on something and I fell down. Now, you could give a choice of what do I do from each one of these. Do I complain about what happened to me? Do I accept it? Do I move on? Now, you could also make it go into a good direction where some benefit comes, you know, of this. The point is for us to understand that every day in our lives, we've got a choice to make, and there are certain things that limit us, and there are certain things that we've got a choice of. So for example, the rain that comes down, okay, it gives me a choice of what to do, but it doesn't necessarily make me have to do one thing or another. Not every qadr of Allah pushes us directly to have to do something. We still have our choices. Sometimes we may not be left with much choice, but we have a choice. And sometimes, even if Allah Azza wa Jal makes us do something, we don't know of how it's going to be judged on Day of Judgment. We leave it to that, because Allah is going to be just by the end of it, of explaining His hikmah and His wisdom for something that happened. Now, having these groups will be able to focus on the fact that we've got that free will, we've got that choice, okay? What you could also do is, you could talk about something that's happening in their lifetime, which they can see where the choices are being made, and by the end there's a result that happens. But it's literally by the choice of those people, okay, that were there. I'll give you an example. So for example, looking at football, okay? Football, you've got a ball that is now, you know, being kicked about by different players, fine. But let's just look at the 11 players within a single team, right? Now you've got the midfielder that has the ball. The midfielder, he can shoot the ball straight into the goal if he wants, or try to take the ball himself, or he's got a choice of passing it onto a striker. Now the striker can again decide that I'm going to just try and score a goal, or he could pass it on to another striker. The striker sometimes can pass it back to a midfielder because there's too many defenders of the other area here. Now they've got a choice of what they do. Now by the end of the game, what happens is usually is that there's always analysis of the whole game. Oh, this player was positioned here. This player could have moved over there. He had so much gap around him. Oh, this defender didn't hang around. The defender of the opposite team could have stayed with the striker of his opposite team and stayed with him and hovered over him, making sure that he doesn't get a chance to make a run. They always make this analysis later on. But when you look back at the analysis, you can see the mistakes that you made. But can you say that you didn't have a choice? No, you had a choice. All right. Now, different players will say, oh, man, if you had passed me that ball at this time, then I could have, scored. I had it there. I was there. I was by the goal. It wouldn't have been offside. You could have just passed it to me. Why did you have to shoot that way? The thing is, you can say that, but the choice was made by those players. And end of the day, end of the whole of the game, you can look back and say, well, this could have been better and that could have been better. But the choice was never taken away. But at the same time, you were all on the field. You were restricted by certain things. So you couldn't touch the ball with your hand. That would be a foul. That's a restriction. You can't basically, hold the ball or something between one's, thighs or something and start jumping about. You can't do that. That's against the rules, okay? You can't cross the ball over the white line outside of the football field and still expect somebody to still carry on playing with the ball and bringing it back in. No, once it's gone outside the line, then that's counted as, the ball now goes to the other player. They will throw it back into the field, okay? So there are restrictions that get placed. Now, even when you want to score, you have to score within that goal. And even when you score, sometimes you can hit the bar and sometimes you can be pushed back. And with all the dynamics of the football ground, you've got so many things that are happening. Some things for you, some things against you. You are restricted to certain things and you are not restricted to certain things. All of that are your restrictions, but within that, you've got your free will. And you move within the power that you've got to do. You make your choice of where you want to give the ball, who you want to give it to, whether you want to take it yourself and score, whether you want to tackle a defender. That's all your choice, okay? That's all your choice. So the choice is never taken away. Now, with these live examples of what's happening in the lives of the children, we want to demonstrate that this is very much practical of what's happening. Now, it doesn't end there because we want them to now, go away from this lesson and understand that any future event that ever happens in their real life, not just a football game or something, okay, not just something that where there's a game being played, no, any real life thing that happens, serious things that happen, we've got to understand that there is the greater hikmah of Allah Azza wa Jal, His awareness of all the events. He doesn't take our free will away. We are responsible for what we have done. And there's also there's the ghaib and the unseen that we don't know of. And whatever misfortune we ever come across, okay, we should know that Allah Azza wa Jal is going to explain everything by the end. Just like Musa alayhi salam explained, Musa alayhi salam, he had Khidr explaining to him everything that happened in the end. And that made Musa alayhi salam well aware of what had happened. Same way, we will be on the Day of Judgment and Allah will explain every single event in our lives and we will fully be aware of what has happened. Because Allah has said, يَوْمَ يَأْتِي تَأْوِيلُهُ. The day when explanation will be given, right? يَأْتِي تَأْوِيلُهُ. The day when the explanation is given, then it'll be clear of why certain things sort of happened. That's in the Holy Quran. So what we want by the end of this is we want them to understand that we've got our free will, we've got our choice, but we are also limited in some ways with the Qadr of Allah. We'll never know what it is, but by the end of everything on the Day of Judgment, it will make sense, but we will be responsible for what we have done on the earth and the way we actually reacted to certain things on the earth. Now that's the whole point of it, inshallah. And also in the secondary school, when they're covering this, they will come across tough questions. You know, why is Allah doing this? And, you know, why doesn't Allah do that? Why doesn't God do this? Why doesn't God do that? Now, this whole lesson will give a basis for them to at least say, you know what? We're humans, we're limited. So we know that the whatever Allah is doing, whatever God is doing is beyond us. And we know that it's all being done for a reason that will be explained to us. And we will see the intricate details of it later on. We'll know the wisdom of it. So right now, when they're faced with certain tough questions in secondary school, they know that they're able to actually deal with them to some level, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.